Rakesh. So now here we end our formal inaugural program, and now we are ready to start with today's session. We have with us Dr. S. V. Morrill, a genuine researcher and down-to-earth person with a vast teaching and research experience. He completed his PhD at the age of 23 years and DSc when he was 30. His area of research includes thermoluminescence, optically stimulated luminescence, and lamp phosphors. He has also carried out work related to UV-emitting phosphors for phototherapy and phosphors for solid-state lighting, and has 3 patents to his credit, 1 for UV-emitting phosphors and 2 for solid-state lighting. His work also includes solar cells. He has guided 30 students for PhD till now and has over 300 publications in SCI journals. He has completed 14 various projects. He is a life member of Indian Physics Association, Vidarbha University's Physics Teachers Association, Forum for Higher Education, and Marathi Management. Madam, I welcome you, sir, to present your talk on using luminescence for solar photovoltaics. Before I hand over the session to Morrill, sir, I appeal to all the participants to please put their questions and queries in the chat box only after the talk. Thank you so much, and over to you, Morrill, sir.
Screen share karo. Hello, good morning everybody. Thank you madam for very kind introduction. Actually it feels great to enjoy the technology. Here we were rooted to our respective places due to lockdown, and thanks to the technology that we are now discussing and having a sort of online conference. Really, hats off to the technology. Well, today I am going to speak about the how we can use luminescence for the solar photovoltaics. Basically, luminescence had been our field of research for quite some time now. Now, if we come to energy, then in the modern world, this world energy, it has become synonymous with the development. The per capita consumption of energy, this has often been taken as an index of development. So how much energy you are consuming, that tells you how much developed you are. Even the social progress, so it is not only the development in terms of infrastructure, but also on some societal indices also, the per capita consumption of energy correlates very well. For example, if we just look at this chart of consumption of energy, then you will see that in the United States, the consumption is huge. So it is in Europe and Japan, and then slowly it comes down, so that we are still towards the end of this chart. However, we find that in order to develop, our energy needs, they are ever demanding, and power sector is struggling very hard to keep pace with ever increasing demand. So we set up some power station, we set up facilities to generate some megawatts, and we see that demand is increased much more. And most of the energy is still produced from fossil fuels like coal and petroleum. However, we know that the stock of these fossil fuels is limited and it is quite near exhaustion. So what is the solution? So this cartoon depicts that, you know, we have been digging down and looking for the solution, whereas this solution is staring at us from the top. So we really need not look much farther for the solution. We have got the solar energy. So energy problem, in terms of science, energy problem is solved with the discovery of photoelectric effect, that is converting light into electricity. And we have light in form of sun. So sunlight is available free of cost. It is inexhaustible. This energy is pollution free. What more do we want? So actually, this saying in Marathi, this is very apt for describing solar energy. Anant haste kamala varane, deta kiti gheshil do karane. So what it means is that the sun god, it's also called as Bhagwan Sahasra Rashmi, means God with thousand hands. So he is giving you with infinite hands. How much can we accept with our two hands? So limitation is because of our devices. Energy is not limited. Energy is available. It is abundant there. It is our devices that is really what matters. So there are really several ways of harnessing solar energy, such as we have got solar thermal. So where we use heat of coming from the sun directly. It can, power your boilers. Then you can convert water into steam. Again, it can be used for generating electricity or running furnaces and so on. Then there is also some solar thermochemical. So solar light can be used to start chemical reactions. And these chemical reactions can be used for generating energy also. Purely solar chemical like photosynthesis, solar water splitting is included in that, and solar photovoltaics. So several formats are there for harnessing the solar energy. So out of all these, solar photovoltaic conversion is most convenient, because we know most of the modern gadgets run on electricity. So converting sunlight into electricity, that is going to be most convenient and popular also. So these, what are the problems in harnessing this energy? As I told you in the beginning, that limitations are due to our limitations of our devices. So initial solar cells were very costly, and they were considered suitable for high-end applications like powering instruments on satellite. So the realization that the fossil fuels are limited, it came slowly much later, especially with the Arab-Israel wars around 1967 or so. It was realized that even supply chain is fragile. So we cannot be assured all the time that from Arab countries we will get on the crude and so on. So that made a scientist think about the alternative form of energy. So using solar energy as an alternative to conventional power, then it was seriously considered. So we can rephrase the problem of energy. You know, entire world's energy demand can be met by covering only 0.4% of our surface with say 15% efficient photovoltaic panels. So we need not look beyond any other source. But there are problems. That solar energy, we know, is not available at a constant rate. Even during daytime, the photovoltaic panels, they have to track the sun for optimum energy production. And then cost of our harnessing, initially it was very high compared to the fossil fuels, which were relatively very cheap in those days. So it is rather irony that we mine it, from the depth of the sea. But whatever is shining just on top of our head, it is difficult or it is more costly to tap that source of energy. So the challenge is that we have the science, But we have to convert this science into viable, commercially viable, financially viable technology. Now, how I will come to my topic as to how luminescence can help in this problem. So luminescence can really play an important role in solving both these problems, how to convert science into technology. So in the first phase, luminescent solar concentrators were devised. Now the concept is simple. A luminescent layer, it absorbs. Essentially, photoluminescence is converting light of one wavelength to the other wavelength. And this light is emitted after some short decay. So a luminescent layer absorbs sunlight and it emits at wavelength for which solar cell is most sensitive. So since luminescence is isotropic, it means it does not depend on angle of incidence and the angle of observation. It is emitted equally in all directions. So tracking the sun, that problem is solved. That is not required and it simplifies the design of solar power station. Now the second phase, it started much late. For this, phenomenon of down conversion is proposed to be used for increasing efficiency beyond Shockley phasor limit. I will explain these terms as we proceed. So increasing the efficiency will automatically reduce the cost per unit energy. And efforts are now focused towards this. So this second concept of down conversion is rather elaborate. High energy solar radiation, which is not converted by solar cell, this quantum is cut into two quanta, which fall in the spectral response of the solar cell. That is the concept. So we'll first see what are the luminescent solar concentrators. Most solar cells, they cannot efficiently convert the light in region 300 to 500 nm. So mechanism to track the sun is also necessary for efficient absorption. These have been the problems of initial solar panels. So luminescent solar concentrators, these are in short waveguides doped with luminescent centers which can spectrally and spatially concentrate sunlight. What I mean is that it absorbs light from various spectral regions and then it focuses at the wavelength for which the solar cell is most sensitive. So that is the spectral concentration, and also because of several total internal reflections, the light from a large region is focused on a small region of the solar cell. That is the concentration in space. So I am also giving some references for this. So this is really the working principle of the luminescent solar concentrator. These fluorescent materials will absorb near ultraviolet light, which is not converted by solar cells, and it is emitted in all directions equally in form of a near infrared light. And due to total internal reflection, this re-emitted light is highly concentrated on small edges of the collector plate. And since this photoluminescence is isotropic, tracking the sun is completely unnecessary. Now, if we look at the solar energy cost, the major cost, you know, is because of the crystalline silicon. Now, if you look at the history, you will see that this cost has come down in 1977. Nowadays, thanks to Chinese technology, it has become quite cheap. Even though there is a huge reduction in global prices, it is still really not at par with the conventional sources. So in India, the silicon-based devices, these are still imported. And we know now with standoff with China, we are totally depending on China for the solar cells. So this dependence, you know, is not desirable. Still, for installing solar power stations, we need about rupees 90 to 100 per watt or non-battery based systems, these are the installation charges, not the maintenance charges, and about 200 per watt for battery based systems. So for the cost reduction, what are the options? First option is to use less costly material. You know, the most commercially successful solar cell is crystallized silicon, and it is an ironing. That silicon is very abundant, you know. In Earth's crust, you find silicon, but the silicon cannot be directly used. It has to be purified, and the device grade silicon is very costly, and few developed countries only have mastered this technique, and they hold the patent for this technology. So what is the option? The option is you can use less costly material, like for example polymers, etc., or use less quantity of material. So by reducing the quantity of material, the cost of solar cell can be reduced. All these three factors. We know that in crystalline silicon solar cell, the cost is due to cost of silicon. So sacrificing efficiency, some low cost materials like polymers, titanium oxide, etc., these can be used. They are low cost, their efficiency is also low. Dye sensitized solar cells, for example, these were developed on these lines. These had an efficiency typically of 5 to 6%, but they are low cost. Then second concept is using less material. You know, silicon is indirect band gap material. So in fact, it is not the best material for harnessing solar energy, but ironically, it is still most successful. Its efficient absorption coefficient is low. So in order to have sufficient amount of absorption, we have to use thick crystal, relatively thick crystal. It means more material, it means increase in cost. So if we use direct band gap semiconductors, for example 2-6 semiconductors like CDS and CDT with high absorption coefficients, then it enables fabrication of thin solar cells, and we will require smaller amount of material. So in principle, we ought to save on the cost. However, these materials are not as efficient as crystallized silicon. That is one problem. Moreover, silicon technology was already established for fabricating other electronic components, so there was not much capital investment needed. Now, that leaves us the third option, you know, of how to increase the efficiency. For that, we have to understand what are the factors which limit the efficiency. So this solar energy, you know, is distributed over wide spectral range. Solar spectrum starts, that is received on Earth, starts from 300 nm to almost 3000 nm. And the solar cells, they do not have uniform conversion efficiency over this entire spectral range. So only a small window of the solar spectrum is utilized for the photovoltaic conversion, and rest of the energy goes waste. See, the radiations which are not used, these are converted by using luminescence to suitable spectral region, then overall efficiency will obviously increase. Yeah, this is the distribution, you know. So about 4 to 5% is in the ultraviolet region, 300 to 400 nm, and solar cells are not at all sensitive to this region. Then about 43% energy is in the visible region. So this is from 500 nm onwards is used by most of the solar cells, and part of the infrared almost up to 1000 nm. Energy beyond 1000 nm is again not used by common solar cells. Yeah, these are the responses of the common materials, you know. So amorphous silicon, a narrow window from say 500 to about 700 mm. If we look at the crystalline silicon, then from 500 mm to almost say 1000 or 1100 mm. And then if you look at the 2-6 materials like CDT, then it uses a very narrow region from 500 to about 800 mm. CIGS, it is a bit broader than crystalline silicon. So these are other gallium arsenide and the organic and so on. And this is the solar spectrum. So now you will know that this part of solar spectrum is not effectively used. This part is also not effectively used. So based on this analysis, theoretical efficiencies of various solar cells were calculated, and these are known as the Shockley-Quasar limits. So it should be emitted, light should be emitted somewhere here where the efficiency is good, and light from this region should be absorbed. Now we have again studied various phosphors. So strontium borate doped with samarium 2+, this is one of the best phosphors. You know what we have got here, that this is the excitation spectrum. So we find that light from 300 to almost 510 mm is absorbed by this phosphor. And you know, the shaded region, this is the region to be converted to 600 or 800 mm. So what this phosphor is doing is it is absorbing the light in this region, and it is emitted in form of narrow lines here. So this is the region where solar cell efficiency is good. So if you can coat this phosphor on CDS CDT solar cell, then again efficiency of this solar cell will increase greatly. So with help of this phosphor, we can hope to improve the efficiency of this solar cell. And some experiments have already been done, but we still have not come up with a device. Another cell is the CIGS, that is copper indium gallium sulfide selenide, this type of phosphorus. So the band gap of this CIS, this can be reduced by adding the gallium here. So we have got the CIS and CIGS type of solar cells. Again, we find that this CIS, this is sensitive only up to this 1100 mm, whereas CIGS, its solar spell, its spectral response extends beyond even crystalline silicon. So in principle, we should have conversion efficiency exceeding that of the crystalline silicon solar cell, provided we can use this energy. This energy, you know, from 300 to 500 is totally wasted. It is not converted by these solar cells. So again, we propose to use phosphorus for conversion of this light to suitable longer wavelength. So again, we have studied several phosphors. This is one example. This phosphor is potassium. This is quite low cost, you know, and very simple to make. You take potassium chloride, strontium chloride, and europium chloride, dissolve them in distilled water. or a hydrochloric acid, and then simply boil off, and you get this phosphor. So what are the properties of this phosphor? This phosphor absorbs light from say 350 nm to about 410 nm. And then this light is emitted, then europium emission is somewhere in the blue region. But there is energy transfer from europium 2 plus to neodymium. So the light in ultraviolet region is absorbed by europium. Then the absorbed energy is given to neodymium, and the final emission is from neodymium. Neodymium emission is here. So we find that again it falls in that part of the spectrum of the energy response curve where so this solar cell is quite appreciably sensitive. So if we can use such a phosphor, then we can use this part of the spectrum. Again, this is not ideal. Ideally, we should have a phosphor which will absorb from 300 nm to almost 500 nm. Right. Now, such phosphors perhaps could be nitride phosphors or some thiogalate phosphors. However, these phosphors are difficult to make. And up till now in India, we have not prepared nitride-based phosphors. And Chinese are preparing these phosphors, but these are still costly. But as a future development, we are planning to make these phosphors which will absorb from 300 to 500 nm light in nitride based phosphors. Or we can also think of the semiconductor phosphors which will absorb from 300 to 500 and then transfer energy to either neodymium or ytterbium, which can emit in this near infrared. Now, the next in the line and which are highly talked about are the perovskite solar cells. So these perovskite solar cells, these are very attractive because basically they are solution processable. The luminescence is sort of molecular type of luminescence. It means even in say liquid form also, they are giving luminescence. And they are not losing the property. So you can dissolve it and then you can apply the coating, boil off the solvent, and all the properties are retained. So that is one of the advantages, you know. So recently in the last 6 to 7 years, there is huge research going on perovskite type of solar cells. And now the efficiencies of these solar cells, this is almost comparable with that of the crystalline silicon solar cell. So I already told you that it is solution processable. That is one advantage point. Cost is low. So there are not very high cost materials involved. But this is still an emerging technology, and the problem like say degradation and stability, such problems are still to be solved, because upon continuous exposure to ultraviolet light, there is degradation of the material. So this problem is still to be solved before this can be commercialized. So what is the solution? The solution is again that we can use downshifting material. So this material will absorb light less than 400 nm falling on the these perovskite solar cells and re-emit in the visible region in say green or red region, which can be utilized by this perovskite solar cell. So it will be, you know, a double benefit. There will be improvement in the efficiency, and also it will reduce the UV light induced degradation. So we have several such phosphors, you know. For example, this is CZCS doped with europium. You know, it has got excellent absorption, very broad band absorption, right from 300 nm to up to 450 nm. So it will absorb this light and convert it into 510 nm light which is efficiently converted by this. There is another phosphor. It is commercially known phosphor. This is thiogalate, and this has also very broad excitation spectrum, and this is the emission spectrum. So again, we find that it emits at around 535 nm. So this phosphor can also be adequate. There is LUAGC phosphor. So several phosphors are there. With you, at this stage, we are not claiming that all the problems are solved. The technology, this is still, I mean, a science and not converted to technology. The problem is that we have some sort of watertight windows, you know. People who are working with solar cells and semiconductors, they are not conversant with the luminescence and luminescence techniques. Whereas people who are working in field of luminescence, they are not conversant with the solar cells, how to measure the efficiency and related problems, you know. So we are now making efforts. In fact, the purpose of giving the talk on this broad platform is that I will get some people interested, you know, from IITs and also some special institutes, you know, situated in Hyderabad, NPL. These institutes have got excellent facilities for working. In fact, there is a nano center at IIT Powai. So there are excellent facilities for even fabricating solar cells, all sorts of solar cells, whether it is crystalline silicon or CIGS or CDS-CDP. And then if we can collaborate with these people and prepare the phosphors, especially we'll have to prepare these phosphors in a form, maybe nano film or nano layers, which will not hinder or obstruct the sunlight from reaching the solar cell. So that is the second thing, that we have to make the phosphors and make putting on the solar cell, and they study the properties of these solar cells. So right from the paper by Trupke et al, which I think came up in 2002 or something, 18 years have gone, but not significant progress has been done. One of the reasons also is that in Europe and US, they will not benefit much from the solar energy to that extent, because they do not get that much solar light due to their geographic situation. We in India and many Asian countries stand to benefit most from this solar energy. So I think improvement may not come from abroad. We will have to work for ourselves. As our Prime Minister had put it, we will have to be Atmanirbhar. We will have to have our own research, our own solar panels, which are, say, coated with these down conversion layers and which can exceed the efficiencies, say efficiencies up to say 38% or so. Once that is achieved, then the cost of solar energy will be almost at par with the conventional energy sources which use the fossil fuels. So that is our next target. It depends, you know, how soon or how later we can achieve our goal. I hope that this seminar will take us somewhat further in securing the collaboration with some of these premier institutes, and our research scholars can prepare the phosphors, take it in proper form to these institutes and put on the solar cell. Thank you very much. It had been such a pleasure to talk to you people, and I don't know whether there is a provision to take up questions in form of chat or something. So I hand you back to the organizers. Thank you once again for giving me this opportunity.
Very good afternoon to all of you. I, Dr. Archana Ramjake, representing STTP team KDKC. I'm first of all thankful to Dr. S.P. Modil sir for giving such a valuable high-end information on using luminescence for solar photovoltaics. Thank you so much, sir, for generously sharing your time and expertise. Clears the doubt of solar cells. Then it's a question answer session now. I request all the participants to ask their questions in the chat box, please. Sir, there is a question from Umesh Palikumar, sir. Will not Beer Lambert absorb? Hello, sir.
Am I audible? We have several questions here, you know.
Yes. Am I audible, sir?
Where are these questions?
Hello.
Acha.
Sir, there is a question from Umesh Palikundwar, sir. Will not Beer Lambert absorption takes place for useful solar spectrum if we coat the solar cell? How can we overcome that?
Please, could you repeat it? I missed it first.
Yes, time. Yes, sir. Will not Beer Lambert absorption take place for useful solar spectrum if we coat the solar cell? How can we overcome that?
Yes, these phosphors must be transparent to the region, say 400 to 700 or 500 to 700 nm, 500 to even basically 1100 nm, which is useful for the solar material. So transparency is absolutely essential. That is one of the conditions for the phosphors.
Okay, thank you, sir. There is another question from Nitin Sali. Sir, how can we improve the efficiency of solar cell from different materials?
Yeah, I have considered four types of solar cells here. Basically, PSSC, PSC, CDS-CDT, CIGS, and the crystalline silicon. Now, these are the four major contenders, you know. But we can study the EQE curve for those solar cells. That is the quantum external quantum efficiency curve. And then from this study, we will know which is the region which is not converted by that solar cells. Then we can design a phosphor. It will absorb the light in that region and convert it to the light where that particular solar cell is responsive. So we can design phosphor for any type of solar cell.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Sir, next question from Shri Laitha, Dr. Shri. What type of perovskite materials can be used for solar cells?
Right now, they are using mostly CSPB-BR3 type materials or methyl ammonium lead bromide. Then, because lead is toxic, they have gone into the CSSNI3, CSSNBR3 type of materials also. And a lot of work is done, you know. There is also, people are also applying machine learning techniques. So they have found out with using computer program some 10,000 materials which basically can be suitable for making perovskite type of solar cells. Now, whether these materials are formed, so chemistry and materials aspect of that has to be found out. In fact, in recent 2019 and 2020 papers of Physical Review Materials, that is a journal, they have given a list which they have generated by machine learning process. So there is huge opportunity for experimentalists. We can go through their list and find out which are the materials which can be made.
Sir, next question is from Dr. Piyush. What is the main reason for low efficient solar cell?
For?
Low efficient solar cell.
Yeah, basically solar energy is distributed over a very wide region. you know, right, even the energy light we are missing from Earth's atmosphere is from 350 to about 3000 nanometer. And our solar cells are based on semiconductors. Now, semiconductor will not absorb all this light. So light which is greater than, which is a lower energy than the band gap will not at all be absorbed by the solar cell material. That light will go waste. Also, very high energy light that will be reflected back or there will be scattering. So for one absorbed photon, you will get only one electron hole pair. So even if energy doubles, the solar output does not double. That is the problem. So that limits, you know, this is technically called as the Shockley Quasar limit of the solar cell.
Sir, there is a question from Jitendra Ladal. Would you clarify on manufacture of semiconductor material in India?
Oh, I don't think I'm an expert on that. But from whatever I have tried to gather, that we are not at all manufacturing device-grade silicon. That is a huge problem. Even when I was in MSc, in 74, I saw some projects in big labs of growing silicon from rice husk and all those things. In 2016, I took my students to the lab and again similar projects were done. So essentially in these 14 years, we have achieved very little. I mean, I stand to be corrected and I will be very glad to be proven wrong, but we have not achieved silicon grade, I mean device grade silicon at commercial scale. So that is our huge problem. So if we have to import silicon, then why not to import directly the solar cell? That's the problem.
Sir, next question. Should we irradiate the sample before we use it?
Irradiate means what? No. This is not a sort of thermoluminescence or the radioluminescence type of phenomena. It is simply photoluminescence. So sunlight is falling on the sample and the light is getting converted. It is simply phenomena of photoluminescence. So no irradiation, etc. is necessary.
Sir, next question is introduction of phosphorus made any kind of changes in the parent material?
No, it is not phosphorus. Huh? Don't confuse with phosphorus. It is the phosphor. And as I told you, it is the technology which is to be developed. So we will have to use the phosphor, which will not diffuse into the solar cell material. Unfortunately, not many experiments have been done of coating the phosphor on the solar cell. Very few experiments, if at all, have been done. So the two technologies have been progressing parallel. One is the making the phosphor, another is the making the solar cell, and there is no in LED lighting, we have coated the phosphor on a chip for people which are best for and so forth. Huge number of experiments have been done, but for solar cell, such experiments have not been done, and I wish this could be taken up in near future.
Thank you, sir. Sir, there is a question from Suchinder Sharma. Yeah. What is the reason that EM3 plus is not used so often in the scientific community, especially when it has emission around 1500 and 1800 nanometer, along with absorption possibility in the visible region? Do you have some suggestions for host choice in this case?
Yeah, thulium, you know, it has got the orbital energy levels, only FF levels are there. It doesn't have very strong absorption. That is the problem. And then the emission, as far as solar cell is concerned, this emission is around 1500 nm. So it can be used maybe for germanium photocell or gallium arsenide, etc. photocell. For silicon photocell, it will not be of much use. that is the problem. In other applications, thulium is used, for example, lasers and medical lasers, etc. These are made from thulium. And also we have got the thermoluminescence, dosimetry, phosphorus, etc. Also, thulium is very costly. Cost of thulium is about ₹10,000 per gram. So it's very costly also. That is another reason.
Okay, sir, because of running time, it's just a last question. N-type or R or P-type, which one is the best for photovoltaic? It's from Dr. L.C. Nehru.
Basically, it is a diode. So it is a junction diode. So you have both P and N, and a junction is made, you know, for having a solar cell. Crystalline silicon solar cell is basically a P-N junction diode. Then I also request to the organizers that I have got a PPT of this, which is made available to Mrs. Vankhede, or you make you my email ID to the participants. So whosoever wants to go through this, I can mail them this PPT, and they can also chat with me or ask their questions and so on. I am willing to share my WhatsApp number and also the email ID. This is available with Mrs. Vankhede. So I request all participants to get this from her, and then you can communicate with me. I will be very glad.
Yes, sir, many participants requested for the PPT. Thank you so much for your knowledgeable answers, sir. Please connect. I request Professor Aditi Tulankar to continue with the session. Professor Tulankar.
Thank you, Archana, and thank you, Moril sir, for your very informative and wonderful session. Participants are really, they have enjoyed it, and as you said, truly, they want your PPT. So we would definitely share it with them. We will send the emails so that you can share your PPT with all the participants, and thank you so much. Participants, please note that you will be provided with a link for the quiz and feedback in the respective Telegram and WhatsApp groups, which is mandatory to be filled and submitted within the stipulated time, because the certificates will be awarded only on successful submission of all the quizzes and feedback forms for all 6 days of STTP. So it is mandatory. Thank you everyone for patient hearing and active participation. We will meet again tomorrow at 11:30 a.m. sharp for the second day session by Dr. Vijay Kumar Gupta. Till then, goodbye, stay home, stay safe. Thank you all.